So a few days ago, when I made the original Midnight Club 5 video looking into the possibility as to whether or not there was another Midnight Club game on the horizon, in the infancy, in development, whatever, I wasn't actually expecting to make another video on it. There wasn't supposed to be a part 2, it was supposed to be a one-off episode. However, having reading through the comments, and believe me, there was a lot of them, I realised that based on what you guys were saying, that I just had to make a second part to it. Because for one reason or another, there was a reoccurring theme that kept popping up over and over and over again. What I'm going to do now is take the opportunity to read out some of those comments. Now, bear in mind that you guys actually had a lot to say on this topic, but I'll try to get through them as quick as possible. So, first up, we have Steve Reynolds, who says, I like your perspective on the subject, and I, being a huge Midnight Club LA fan and enthusiast, have believed that the reason why Rockstar has added more and more customization, cars, and slightly better physics into GTA 5 is because they wanted to satisfy both markets and game genres. Whenever someone has said that Rockstar should make another Midnight Club, I've always agreed, but said I doubt it due to the current condition of GTA 5 and for the reasons you spoke of in the video. I'm not crossing my fingers, but would welcome a new Midnight Club with open arms. Next up, we had Just the Lad, who says, also, I feel Rockstar could release a new Midnight Club, possibly taking a loss like LG with their phones, and still stay in the black. My only fear with this situation is Rockstar's, and I'm going to use this term lightly, but their greed. Proof? Well, GTA 5, as you stated, over 80 million units sold. That's stupid profit. He's actually right there, it is stupid profit. As the game progressed, DLC was released free of charge. What did they do? They priced everything in the pack stupidly high. My thought on them doing this is make something that the users want, they'll buy it, even if this is with real life money. As a result of this, over $500 million worth of income on shark cards. That's the figure I heard anyway. And by the way, side note, he's correct. That figure is true because I've looked into it. Anyway, I don't see how a company who operates like this would release a game that won't rake in an abundance of cash. Now, this is just my take on it. It very well could be incorrect. I just hope they create a new Midnight Club, not for the profit, but more of a labor of love. Next up, we've got ZapperX7, who says, sure, they won't sell as much, but they know that people are going to buy it if it either looks good, fun, or it's a part of a long-running franchise. If it comes in at the right moment, if it works, if it's all shooters and adventure, it'll sometimes get boring, so they'll push out a good racing game out of nowhere. The car community didn't start off good, but it grows by night. What do Rockstar add for their monthly GTA updates? Cars. I bet Benny's got some good attention. Next up, we've got Masaru Enatsu, who quite simply says, that would explain the GTA 5 microtransactions. We then have Malicious Affection, great name by the way, who says, I think it's coming. They can see that people do have an interest in cars, GTA 5 stats, and the current competition, RNG cards for upgrades, permit for a new entry into the franchise. We now have Seven Sins, who says, great points. Unfortunately, most racing fans will disregard actual numbers from recent years and bring up numbers from the past, not understanding how much has changed in just a generation of gaming. They'll bring up the fact that Gran Turismo sold millions, Forza selling millions, without understanding how much marketing those franchises get. Rockstar can save millions in development by just integrating aspects of Midnight Club into their most profitable IP, which is GTA, and make much more money than a standalone racing game. Sadly, it's the truth in today's gaming world. Look at recent numbers, gamers, not numbers from 5 or 10 years ago. I couldn't agree more. Now we have Dan Jones. Diversification within a business is crucial to spread risk of eating into their own profits. It would actually make a lot of sense for them to develop a Midnight Club, as they already dominate open world sandboxes with their GTA series, and within GTA, the most popular activity by far is the racing components. Far more people will be on GTA races than compared to any other activity. Hence why there are so many updates revolving around it. As someone else mentioned, other competitors' products released recently, e.g. Need for Speed Payback and Forza, seem like complete dog doo-doo. Dan, are you trying to get me banned or something? I can't say that word. Anyway, perhaps I'm just being nostalgic, but one of my most favourite things ever in a game was the go and collect random spread out checkpoints in Midnight Club 2. need stuff like that again. Next, we've got Rob Chamberlain, who comes out with, "You forgot one huge thing about our niche market. We are rabid fans and a vocal and dedicated community. So while the base game numbers say low sales, I'm sure if you look at the add-on sales, these sales jump massively. This is exactly what Rockstar found out in GTA Online. Why do you think they keep making new add-on cars? They sell, so it's not the base game you need to take into account, you need to take the add-on as well. I do agree we won't see another Midnight Club though, as they will fold that game into a new GTA base game, just like they did with GTA 5 online race modes." We've now got I can't pronounce your name, HFJDE. "Midnight Club is my favourite racing series, but I'm perfectly fine without another one. But that said, I hope they add more elements from Midnight Club to future GTA games. They added a lot of customization to GTA 5, but they lacked in the races. Would be nice to have a mix of GTA and Midnight Club in one game." We've got Ayush Dua. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. If I didn't, I'm sorry. "Honestly, they should just combine Midnight Club into GTA 6. From what I know, people drive cars a lot in GTA. They can implement good elements of Midnight Club in it and give us the two dream games that everyone wants from Rockstar in a single one." And last up, we've got Max Bryan. "Couldn't Rockstar just add real cars into the next Grand Theft Auto? I know Rockstar North and Rockstar San Diego are different producers, but they are still affiliated with each other. Make the driving slightly more realistic, not too realistic, as it could result in many not playing the game. Make the story based on street racing, or partially. The customization is already there for most cars, an exciting car list, and boom, a game that can compete with Need for Speed and other open world games. That sounds like a game that can pull in billions in revenue." Okay, so first and foremost, thank you guys so much for your comments. Not just you guys, but every single one of you who dropped your opinion on that video. But I hope you're starting to understand the reoccurring theme that I was talking about. GTA, GTA, GTA. So that got me thinking. It got the juices in my brain flowing, and it started making me look at things at a deeper level. And I started to have this idea in my head was swirling over and over again, as it was a shocking and almost frightening realization. Has GTA 5 inadvertently, accidentally, potentially even maybe even purposely killed off any future Midnight Club? So just like the previous video, there are two discussional points that I want to talk about that I will feel will allow us to look into this at a deeper level. First and foremost, let's take a look at GTA 5 very briefly, specifically the car scene. How big is the GTA 5 car scene? Just how big is it? Well, at the timing of this video going live, as things stand, there are currently 118 different cars in GTA 5. Now, those cars are obviously spread across different categories. You've got sports, you've got coupes, you've got sedans, you've got compacts, you've got muscle. That figure of 118, that is just strictly cars. That doesn't include all of the emergency vehicles, the military vehicles like the tanks. It doesn't include all the aircraft carriers, the helicopters, or anything like that. So as a standalone figure, we are looking at 118 cars. That alone is more than what most other racing games release with. And this, as I said before, GTA 5, let's just remember, at its core is not a racing game. It's an open world action adventure. In terms of bikes, it has 18 different bikes within the game. Again, an insanely large number for a game that supposedly didn't start off with its focus on vehicles. It should come as no surprise that when it comes to the online modes, one of the most popular, if not the most popular activity on GTA Online is the racing-based element. Now, as you guys know, GTA 5 is a massive open world. There's so much you can do in there. There's so many elements that you can take from the single-player aspect and do in the open world, such as arm wrestling, such as tennis, such as miniature golf. All these things are available online, but nothing gets as much replay value, nothing gets as much hours put into it, nothing gets as much daily, weekly, and monthly players worldwide coming back to the game as much as online races. And that would explain the reason as to why there are so many cars within the game. Now, due to the popularity of the online racing activity, that would also explain the reason as to why Rockstar have consistently constantly, relentlessly even, added DLC, car-based DLC. They've added supercars. They've added JDM-style tuners. They've brought old classics back. They've brought lowriders. They even done a whole garage update. Benny's Garage, I believe it was, allowing you to take certain cars that were already deep with customization to what you might even call super builds. No pun intended, Need for Speed. The open world in the game is so vast, so expansive, that if you're a car lover, it's fantastic for you to go out there and explore and also have car meets. People go to the airport to have car meets, which turn into drag races. People go to multi-story car parks within the game, where the ambient lighting is darker and it gives it that more Tokyo drift feel when you meet up with your buddies. Or sometimes it's just meet and crew sessions that are being had. Now, just touching on the point of Fast and Furious, as you guys all know, there are loads and loads of YouTubers out there who are really, really great with their creativity, great with a camera, and have put out loads and loads of cinematic videos. If you type in GTA cinematic videos, more likely than not, you're gonna find something in relation to a car. There are more cinematic videos focused around cars than any other element of the actual game itself, whether it be stance videos, whether it be drifting montages. Robin, the GTA wise guy, I'm pretty certain a lot of you have seen his videos, and none more so than his massive tribute to Paul Walker, which really did look like a scene out of Fast and Furious. And what better way to show off your newly customized car, your newly purchased ride, than by way of social networking. Again, a lot of you may already know that GTA 5 features something called Snapmatic. Based on Instagram, it's an online photo sharing, video sharing, and social networking service. Players can use Snapmatic via the in-game phone to take and upload pictures to the social club. You must have a social club account to save the photos, obviously, but just like Instagram, people can put hashtags next to their photos. When you look around, when you look at in-game photography taken through this service, more often than not, if it's not a selfie of one of your characters, it's a picture of one of your cars. Landscape scenes, night shots, colored effects, action shots, cars flying through the air, slow-mo drift scenes captured with hashtags such as hashtag tunealife, hashtag JDM, hashtag muscle. Once again, allowing car lovers, allowing photographers, allowing anyone with a creative eye to be able to go out there and snap to their heart's content and actually build up a real life portfolio of photos. There are people who have actually taken their pictures and put it on their real Instagram accounts and have now got massive followings worldwide as a result of this. Again, car related. Perhaps one of the biggest aspects and influences in widening the catchment field of the car community gravitating towards Grand Theft Auto 5 is by way of the PC modding community. You may have seen videos online of people playing Grand Theft Auto 5 with real life cars, Lamborghinis, Ferraris, Camaros, Chargers, Challengers, whatever. These are not hacks. There are people out there that are remodeling vehicles or taking existing models of vehicles from other games and actually implementing them into the game files of GTA to give you a more realistic experience. Speaking on the word of realism, don't like the stock handling of GTA 5? Download the PC version. There are appropriate mods out there which give you the ability to change the handling, make it more realistic. On the subject of realism, there's even a mod which gives your car the facility to actually run out of petrol or run out of gas to the point where you need to actually refill it. There have been specially hand-built maps put into the game which give you the ability to drift around fictional mountains and do car meets and have race wars and things like that. This is all modded, and most importantly, it's all car based. This all from the car community. So looking at all the elements that I've just listed above, I think it's pretty safe to say, I think we can all agree that the car scene in GTA 5 is big, probably even bigger than what you realized. So now that we've established this, the next focus is to try and draw comparisons between Midnight Club LA and GTA 5. Because for this to make sense, there has to be comparisons, there has to be links, there has to be tangible sources that show that these two games share the same strand of DNA, for any of this to make sense. So, Midnight Club LA is an open world environment based and set in the heart of Los Angeles. It focuses heavily on various demographics, none more so than the street urban culture. GTA 5 is an open world environment based and set in the heart of a fictional LA. It focuses heavily on various demographics, again, none more so than the street urban culture. crazy customization is what you get in Midnight Club LA. You can customize various parts of your car, including rims, spoilers, hoods, bumpers, exhaust, suspension-based stance tuning, wing mirrors, lights, interiors, grills, panel colouring, window tinting, and more. In GTA 5, you also have crazy customization. Surprise, surprise, the parts that you can customize on your car. Rims, spoilers, hoods, bumpers, exhaust, again, suspension-based tuning, wing mirrors, lights, interiors, grill, panel colouring, window tinting, and more. As mentioned earlier on, Midnight Club LA is a game that consists of more than just cars. You've got a mixture of cars, but you've also got a whole load of bikes for you to use at your disposal as well. GTA 5, a game which consists of a whole magnitude of different cars, as well as, you guessed it, bikes. When it comes to cops, Midnight Club LA is full of them. You can be cruising along the street, cruising along the freeway, and if you so much as look at a cop with the wrong type of side eye, they're going to chase you down, they're going to hunt you down, they're going to catch you, drag you out of the car, and you can be rest assured the long arm of the law will have the upper hand on you. GTA 5, the open world is crawling with cops all over the place. If you so much as breathe heavily out of the wrong nostril, they're going to hunt you down, they're going to chase you down. But obviously, they're not going to stop at arresting you. They're going to shoot you. They're going to come at you by land. They're going to come at you by sea. They're going to come at you by air. It doesn't matter. When those cops are after you, when you've got that 5-star rating, you know you're on death row. So obviously, the cops in GTA 5 are a lot more aggressive, a lot more bloodthirsty. But nevertheless, there is still a comparison to be had. The fact that both games have got a strong presence of cops. Soundtrack. Midnight Club LA has got a whole host of different names that put their pen together, put their instruments together, and laid their vocals on the line for the in-game music. Artists such as Young Jeezy, Nas, 50 Cent, Snoop Dogg, Ice Cube, The Game, Mino, GTA 5 also has a whole host of different hip-hop artists putting the pen to paper. Artists such as Ice Cube, Snoop Dogg, The Game, Gucci Mane, Ludacris, Rick Ross, Dr. Dre, and more. As you can see, the points that I just listed above, those are more than just similarities. That's the same core base elements from one game to the other. But it doesn't stop there. You see, the next 2 points that I'm going to mention seal the deal on this for me. The handling model, the in-game driving, the car physics of GTA 5 was actually overseen and supervised by Midnight Club LA developer Dan Houser. Coincidence or coinkydink? And what better way to pay tribute to the franchise itself, to the franchise of Midnight Club, than creating your very own love letter of thanks in the form of an in-game trophy. You see, in GTA 5, a lot of you probably remember this, a lot of you probably don't, but one of the trophies involves you having to win 5 online races in a custom car of your choice. When you manage to achieve that, what you get is a trophy appropriately named the Midnight Club Achievement. So, what are my thoughts on this? Well, as I mentioned earlier on, I started going into this case study, documentary if you will, with the whole mindset of trying to figure out whether or not GTA, Rockstar I should say, has actually inadvertently killed off Midnight Club when they realized just how successful, just how big, just how popular the motoring scene within GTA 5 actually was, or is I should say. My mindset has actually shifted slightly. To some degree, one could even argue that we've actually been playing a sort of spin-off version of Midnight Club all along, and we just didn't realize it. Based on all of the links that I've managed to put together, based on all of the similarities, based on all of the core game elements that are shared between the games, based on the fact that we've had a developer from Midnight Club overseeing the handling physics, based on the fact that there's an actual achievement in the game dedicated to Midnight Club, we've been asking for a new Midnight Club game. We've been dreaming for a new Midnight Club game. Well, most of us have anyway. Could it be that by way of circumstance, it is actually falling into our lap without us even realizing? As always, guys, thank you so much for coming out and watching this video. Very, very, very much appreciated. Sincerest apologies for it coming out a few days later than what I had hoped. Unfortunately, I recorded the video earlier on in the week and I lost all the audio, so I had to do it all over again. Anyway, that doesn't matter, because what really matters is your thoughts, your views, your opinions on this. Do you think that Rockstar have actually used GTA 5 to kill off the Midnight Club series? Looking at things from a different perspective now, do you kind of think that maybe GTA 5 might be a watered down spin-off version of a Midnight Club game? Or do you just have a totally different angle and perception on this altogether? As you know, I try to read every single comment, so drop yours in. If it's your first time around here, I wish you a born welcome. Hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and swing the damn hell out of the notification bell so you know when the next video drops. More Need for Speed Payback coming on the way. More Gran Turismo Sport is definitely coming on the way. And in the meantime, I'll see you when the next video comes out. Take it easy. Peace.